communication. There has been no deliberate attempt at all to obfuscate or envelop my audience in a state of ogamoga. No. Far from me. Like I've always said, it's just that by the grace of God and by the grace of the great grand architect of the universe, I put my nose to the grindstone, and I'm sort of an omnivorous reader. I read practically everything that come across my way. I'm sure you can see here now the mystical life of Jesus. This may be outside the purview of an ordinary lawmaker or a lawyer, and if you are a polyvalent and an elliptical reader, chances are that you are bound to come across one or two idiolects. And if you make it as your pastime to be able to know every new word you come across, what they stand for, you they are part and parcel of you. And when you speak, at times they come like the rattle of a gun, and that goes beyond my control, you know. But to say that I, as Honorable Patrick Obahiagbon, I've deliberately set out to mystify my audience is far from it. And it's an opportunity again for me to use the platform of Sahara Reporters, a latitudinarian platform, to render an unreserved apologia to my audience if at any point in time, you know, they find it a little bit difficult to comprehend what I am saying. I want to apologize that that is not intentional at all. Excepting you are saying that I should be deaf and dumb. Excepting you are saying that I should not speak. You know, so an apology again. I can't stop reading.
And even if, having said that, but when we look at even your contribution at the floor of the house, you've been you've been quite hard when it comes to issues of the state of the nation. I remember one of your contributions during the disappearance of the former president, late Musa Yar'Adua. Being a member of the PDP, you know, how did you feel at that point in time, going contrary to the general feelings of members of your political party, to take an opposing view?
No. You see, as a parliamentarian, you have more than one or two or three constituencies. You have loyalty to your party, you have loyalty to the nation, and you have your loyalty to your conscience. And for me, I have never found myself in any quandary as to the fact that when there is a mishmash, when there is an interpose between loyalty to your party or loyalty to your nation or loyalty to your conscience, you must tilt the scale in favor of the nation. You must tilt the scale in favor of your conscience. So for me, even when the entire National Assembly at that point in time, both the House of Reps and the Senate, took a position that it was not the business of the National Assembly to call on late President Yar'Adua to transmit a letter to the National Assembly, my conscience wriggled. And I thought that we were just being political hallelujah boys. So at my expense, I called a World Press Conference saying, no. 2 years, the provisions of the Constitution made it discretionary. But the National Assembly could call on the President to exercise that discretion in favor of public safety, in favor of the stability of democracy. And once I heard that view, irrespective of the fact that it ran against the grain of the leadership of the National Assembly, irrespective of the fact that he ran against the grain of my political party, I became an happy man. And for me, my happiness is what matters to me. And that was why, again, when we were told that a presidential jet flew in the late president into the country without the imprimatur of the then acting president. I came again on the floor of parliament to say, no. I see this as a veritable boogaboo, which must be poo-pooed by all composed mentis homo sapiens.
And was that why you crossed to the Action Congress of Nigeria? Because I'm made to aware you've left the PDP for the ACN.
Yes, I am a member now of the Action Congress of Nigeria, Edo State. That itself has generated the life controversy of ISO. But the way I look at this matter is that I take Suko in Plato. Plato said that at all point in time in any democracy, the people and only the people must remain the philosopher kings. And I find myself in Edo State, where a preponderant number of my constituents are devastated from the People's Democratic Party to the Action Congress of Nigeria for no reason other than the fact that the comrade governor himself, Comrade Adams Oshomole, has given meaning to governance. Edo State, that was in a state of economic quagmire, political phantasmagoria, and social stupor, was gradually transmogrified into a state of infrastructural Eldorado. So you see a dominant number of my constituents adjusting to the Action Congress of Nigeria. And I can't stay here. I can't stay here, Kayode, to begin to admire the bridges in Abuja and pretend not to see the yearnings, not to listen to the yearnings and aspirations.
What if your opponents call it political opportunism? That, well, you say Oshiomhole and the Action Congress being the party of the day, you left the ideology of the PDP to the ideology of the ACN. What do you have in common with the Action Congress in terms of policy?
What is the ideological difference? What is the ideological difference between the PDP and the ACN? What is the ideological difference between the PDP, ACN, and other political parties? If there is any ideological difference at all, it's one of a twiddly dum and twiddly dee. No basic ideological difference. It's all elitists, a band of elitists gathering together, you know, for the sole purpose of acquiring political power to see how that political power could be deployed either in service of the nation or in service of self. Those are the issues. Then it will become very, 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 very difficult. Do we really have political parties in Nigeria? Do we really have political parties in Nigeria? I really don't think that we have political parties in Nigeria. It's like you telling me now that we are celebrating 50 years of democracy. No. We are celebrating 50 years of civilian rule, for example. It's not democracy. We are not a democratic country yet. We are a civilian country. Yes.
I initially saw that
as a policy that did not reflect the reality of the moment. Until the president himself explained that this was not the process he started, that the three presidential jets bought had a faucet origo in the administration of the late President Umaru Yar'Adua, and he only saw it into a finishing point. That again became what gave me some kind of mental sanity. But again, I still would have thought that never happened at all. Because even if it happened in the regime, even if the process was started in the regime of the late President Umaru Yar'Adua, In line with the consciousness of the moment, one really would have thought that Mr. President would have stopped that exercise.
There's been a lot of outcry, even internationally, about the allowance allocated to members, to Nigerian lawmakers. Do you agree that the money being paid members of the lawmakers is outrageous?
I will say two things here. One, I would react to what constitutes the salaries and allowances of lawmakers. Two, I would add to a lot of misinformation in the public domain. For example, when you talk about constituency allowances, which is being dubbed and stigmatized jumbo pay. It will interest you to know that honorable members do not know the contractors that execute projects in their respective constituencies. So it is not as if to say that you put in the hands of honorable members XYZ sum of amount and say go and execute constituency projects and the pocket this money. No. That is a lot of misinformation in the public domain. But again, as to whether the salaries and allowances of parliamentarians reflect the acerbic, caustic, and corrosive nature of the Nigerian infrastructure today, I want to say that I am in pari materia with not just the international public. I'm in pari materia with the Nigerian public that it is something all stakeholders, it is something the Nigerian parliamentarians may want to sit down again and assess. Because after all, we cannot live over and above the Nigerian society.
Now, let us speak about the Speaker of the House of Reps, Timothy Bankole. This is probably one of the most controversial speakers we've had in recent times. And you know the case of the legislators that were literally beaten up, you know, by Orofandu at the floor of the House. Were you at that sitting, and what position did you take then? And on the issue of corruption and the leadership of the House of Reps, are your members doing anything about it? It seems that not a lot is coming out of the investigations that are conducted.
Let me say that it was unfair. It was unfair, and it was a maladroit saga, cum gargantuan gaga, that incident happened at all on the floor of the House. It was bestial, it was deprecable, and it was one of the low moments of the National Assembly. I do not believe, and I still do not believe, that what was meted out to those who alleged certain facts and issues against the leadership of the House would have been outright expulsion, would have been outright suspension for the rest of their tenure. Because if you look at it, this is a democracy. Parliament is supposed to be a constant morums of the people, having superintendence over umbrages, contracts, bonus more. Parliament is supposed to be the watchdog of society. How do we have the moral bastion? Where is the moral and social and sociological wicked for us to continue to formulate, for us to continue to declare what we see as executive excesses and didoisms when within parliamentary precincts and confines? Parliamentarians make certain allegations, and all you can do is to put them on suspension. I'm not looking at the merits of those allegations now, because he who alleges must prove. That is for those who allege those facts. But the way and manner Parliament reacted in an Bismarck-like approach, with an iron-fisted approach, gave the impression, and still do give the impression, that there is something to hide. And I want to use this forum, like I've done before, to call on the leadership of the House to have a rethink on the suspension of those members. If they are unable to prove their case quadrant demonstrandum to a fixation of quadrant fascinatum, at that stage you can now subject them to the Ethics and Privileges Committee of the House. But a mere allegation, you've not given them time to prove it.